the sites have found, as I'm so proud of this wonderful community, so I wanted to share that with them, as they now share their ministry with us. So welcome back, Tom.
Thank you. Good evening. So tonight we'll just go 3 or 4 hours, that's all. You're always laughing, that's it. It's funny. Did you enjoy last night? Was that a good night? It makes us happy. What if you guys were boo?
We thought you'd be any better tonight.
But would you mind sharing with me what was your experience? God ruin any of your plans? Did he tell you to sell your piano? We'll have a chance tonight to reflect, but I just thought, informally, we're family, right? We're not performers. We're here sharing our faith with you and the love of God, and you're sharing your faith with us and the love of God and your ice cream. And it's a great relationship. Carl has sampled the cookies already. I want you to know. They're downstairs. I walked over and a gentleman said those are for after the music. Well done. So anybody, we had some interior prayer last night. We had some silence. It didn't have to be like a big religious experience, but did anybody like to share anything that maybe happened internally? Takes a little courage. Like, you know, I'm supposed to sell my house and give all my money to Father Steve. Stuff like that. Yes, but really loud. Could you stand?
Yeah, this has been wonderful. And I've done a lot of crying and a lot of books like Joyful Cry. And when you asked us to go in and take word, my mind was like, okay, what word should it be? You know, my mind was trying to find a word. I said, you're not supposed to do that. You're supposed to just let it go.
Charity. If you didn't hear her, she said a lot of joyful crying. Cherished. Oh, that's beautiful. Write that down and put it on the mirror. So every day you remind them. There you go. Cherished. Beautiful. Thank you. Great. Yeah. Great courage. Now, I'm not going to point to what direction, but I do see a wife doing this to the husband. There's a good story out there. I'm not going to look over there. Anyone? It's the early church shared their faith with each other. They said, what is God doing in your life? What did Jesus, this risen one, how has he appeared to you? And God appears in different ways. And they would share these stories, and that's how the faith of the early church was built up. So here we are. Come on, fellas. Oh, right next door to the cherished one.
Yeah, when we don't forgive, that person is not in chains. We're in chains.
let's pray. You are all that I need.
Inhaling and exhaling. I Googled this.
see, smell, or taste carbon monoxide. And I was thinking, spiritual breathing is so important because we don't, just like in the physical world, we don't know when we're in danger. We don't get an email, you've been down the wrong road for a while, you're about to really crash. We don't get that. Well, maybe we do if in prayer, or maybe we do as we read scripture, or maybe we do when we come to Mass, but I think we all need encouragement to learn how to breathe. If we're not inhaling, and all we're doing is exhaling, and doing things, and being human doers, we're missing the boat, because there's an inner life that is so important. The inner life is, and I think, the life of God. And the invitation, the contemplative way, is an invitation to go inside, not to navel gaze and to learn just about ourselves, but to discover, as Mother Teresa said, the distress of disguise and the poorest of the poor inside of us. Our own poverty, that we could look at our broken, unique, beautiful, sinful human self and say, I forgive you. Forgive ourselves. So it's important, a healthy spiritual person does both. Breathes in and breathes out. Breathes in the spirit and the reality and the presence of God's love, and then exhales that love and gives it away to the world around us. I recently heard someone talk about a mindset. The mindset of scarcity versus abundance. And you can see people when they operate in one of the two mindsets. Scarcity means, you know, I got to keep mine because I may not get it again, and I got to take care of number one. Abundance says there's enough for everyone. St. Francis said, when you see the immigrants, don't count them as numbers. See them as people, mothers, fathers, brothers, uncles, aunts, grandmas. Scarcity versus abundance. So we're going to kind of review where we are tonight on this little missionary journey, this mission within. When we started, I asked everyone to raise their hand if they were a sinner. Those of you who weren't there that night, this is your chance. Let's all stare. What I asked was this: if you're a sinner, raise your hand. And most everyone did. And then we always see this. You know. In 1982, Sister Dominic, a Dominican sister and friend, said to me, Tom, it's our sin and it's our brokenness, our need for God, our concupiscence, our tendency to sin that unites us. It is often our gifts and our talents that divide us. Again, the false self versus the real self. When we pretend we're someone other than we are, we have less in common. As brothers travel, Carl and I are honest with each other about who we are. We have a friend in common, a guy named Rich Mullins. You're going to hear a couple of his songs tonight. Rich was an incredible musician, an incredible human being, and a big old sinner. You're supposed to laugh right there, because he would laugh. He'd be like, duh, we all are. He was in Germany with a friend of his, and he decided that they'd been friends for a long time, and it was time to just be transparent with his friend. They shared their struggles and who they were. He just decided, I heard him tell the story, I'm just going to tell my buddy really who I am, everything about me, nothing held back. And they're in Germany in a park, and they're sitting on a bench. It's like, everybody here speaks German anyway, so I can tell my friend. So they sat there, and he proceeded to just, we would call it a confession, just, here's who I am. And when he finished, he thought, I wonder how my friend will respond. There's a very famous Christian musician, this guy, Rich Mullins. And when he finished, he didn't realize that the bench had two sides. whether or not I was Rich Mullins. And then he said, yeah, I guess I am Rich Mullins. And you know what? That's what we grew to love about this guy. He was real. He didn't pretend. They actually just made a full Hollywood movie about his life. It's pretty weird to go to a movie about someone who spent 2 years with and his last Thanksgiving dinner. It's pretty weird. Rich Mullins. But in the kingdom of God, the Lord calls us to serve one another, to put our gifts at the service of one another. So that's where the way of Jesus is just different than the world, huh? And it goes against our flesh, because what we want is you take care of me in our worst days, right? Jesus came not to be served, but to serve. We are Christians, we are to imitate Christ and serve one another, the poor, the hungry, those that are addicted, those that are on the outside, the marginalized, the destitute, the immigrant, the stranger in the room. When we're laughing and joking, there's that one person. The straight man. The gay woman. The child. The elderly. Those with, those without. The rich, the poor. Those who are black. Those who are white. Those who are brown. Those who are olive, the Asian, the Pacific Islander, the communist, those others, them. Mother Teresa is such a great example to us as Catholics. She didn't serve and minister to destitute Catholic Christians. She never asked anyone what church they went to. I can tell you that for sure because September 4th of 2016, I read this incredible article. It was the morning of her canonization. I was speaking on Mother Teresa that night. I was with her three times, but I'm no, you know, scholar on her life, but I'm very moved by her life. And they asked the sister her from the very beginning to the end of her life. They said, did Mother Teresa ever, did you ever hear her say, you know, you ought to get to Mass? Or, you know, have you considered becoming Catholic? Or, have you been reading your Bible of late? The sister said, we never heard her ask those questions. Maybe she was asked those questions, but we, Mother Teresa simply love the person in front of you, period. The poorest of the poor, that those in the distressing disguise, but the poorest of the poor. She loved, she served, she saw Christ in every human person. When she was in Phoenix, friends of mine were in charge of the visit, and my one friend was driving the van that Mother Teresa was in. I went around for a few days with the governor, the bishop, the police escort. My buddy was driving the van one day. And she, Mother Teresa was getting in the van, and just before she got in, a hand grabbed her. Was it called a sari? A sari that she would grab it. And it was like a death grip. She would not let go of Mother Teresa. And people were trying to get her to let go of Mother Teresa. And she said, Mother Teresa, pray for my son. He has AIDS and he's disappeared. I will pray for him. Now let go. I will pray for him. But I think it was either the next day or 2 days later, my friend was driving the van and there's police. And as he was driving, he heard, pull over. van, gets out, and starts walking down the street.
Yeah.
So everybody kind of followed her. She went down a block, and then she went down a block. Where's Mother Teresa go? And they walked up, and there was a man sitting on the curb. And he walked up to her, and my friend Phil was there. And the man said, "Mother Teresa?" She said, "Yes." He said, "I have AIDS." And she said, "I know. And your mother misses you." So this inner life certainly enlightened Mother Teresa to see with new eyes and to hear with new ears and to love with a new heart. The child, the unborn, the many people that are in the various forms of prison, those that are crippled by illness, or the many forms of the way that we are crippled. And now it's our turn to be the hands and the feet of Jesus. So the theme of our mini mission is the desert will lead you to your heart, where I will speak. And if we look at the word heart, I'm not sure if we have that slide, but yeah, there we go. It really is about the heart. And as I, in my community where I pray, go to Mass, on the wall of Our Lady of the Desert, it says, "Desert will lead you to your heart where I will speak." I just prayed about what that would mean, because I've been wondering since college. And I looked at the word heart, and I think maybe we need to divide that word into three pieces that, you know, we know that God is not a white man with a beard, but we start with that image of God as Father, and that God alone is enough. We start with He. So in the concert, we focused on God, just praying and seeking God. And then secondly, if we look at the three middle letters of the word heart, it's ear or hear. And last night we focused on hearing and listening and praying on an interior way. And then the last part of the word is art. I think God is calling us. I think the Catholic life is a call to joy, hope, and an incarnational way of seeing the world. Seeing God in the incredible food or friendship. Seeing God in the poor. Seeing God in the sacrament. Seeing God in each other. Even seeing God in ourselves. John Paul the Great, before the year 2000, 1999, he said, "Church, I want you to learn the art of prayer." Art of prayer. So not the discipline of prayer, the challenge of prayer, but the art of prayer. See, John Paul was a thespian. He was an actor. He saw life as a way of art. I was in Hawaii doing a mission, and a priest came up to me and said, "You've just been pouring out your heart to us." I said, "Well, thank you, Father. It's a joy to be here." He said, "I don't have a lot of gifts, sir." Well, that's not true. He said, "But I lived in Rome for 16 years. I'm a good cook." I said, "Tell me more." He goes, "Can I cook you a meal? And do you know, I've thought about that time, not just the food, but that time with him. And we just shared a meal and talked about God and our lives. Wow, what a ministry. So maybe exhale is living as artists. You know, Carl and I, we play music, but there's different ways to live as artists. So that's where this evening is headed. But I want to back up just a little bit. I asked us another question on the first night. Can we love? And I set you up. And we said, yeah. maybe happens to you, that if we don't die to self, then we end up being just really good at religion. We're good at quoting the scriptures. We're good at telling others what they ought to do and how they should act, but we're not really good at doing it ourselves. But the mission of the church is to bring the good news to all the world. That is actually, what is the mission of the church? To immerse the world in the love of God. That's why this building is here. So that we would learn and experience love and grow in love and then go out those doors and be the church out there. Because this building is not the church. It's beautiful, it's sacred, it's holy, it has an incredible history. But you are the church. We are the church. Are priests the church? Of course. Sisters, deacons, the Pope, yes. But all of us, see, Vatican II redefined what the church is. We are the church. Father presides over Mass. He doesn't do the Mass. We are to do. Liturgy is the work of the people. The worst thing we can do is say, good job, Father. Great. Keep going. No. He gives his life away to inspire us to do the same. To be a family. Amen?
Amen.
Amen? See, what happens is Christianity, this is my thing, so this is not a teaching of the church. If you don't like it, it's me. Christianity becomes churchianity. You know, like a set of moral codes where we focus on heretics instead of converts, where we play church instead of coming to Mass and surrendering. We become important, not God. And that isn't the gospel message I'm about. It's just not what I think Jesus is calling us to. We are to bring the good news to all the world, to baptize, to immerse the world. And what happens instead, and this may sound harsh, but we play church. Now, my experience here, the liturgies are so powerful and beautiful and welcoming and inviting. Good on you. Much will be asked of you, as much as being given to you. Keep giving until it hurts. Now, thank you for inviting us. Thank you for allowing us to come and ruin your Monday and Tuesday night, you know? People, you know this, we're all in this. People are desperate. They're desperate. They're so hungry. So, we talk about the desert, So last night, my friend, St. Anthony, with this beautiful fighting painting, stunning, with your strawberries and your beautiful history. This dude from Tucson, you welcomed me and my brother into your midst, and I told you my stories. I shared with you about God's love, actually dispelled the darkness, the fear, and the evil. That song with you, my Lord, I shared my encounter with Mother Teresa after really 30 years of that slow but true healing. I'd like to ask you about your wounds. Could you close your eyes for a moment? Go back inside.
God alone is enough. formal, to let it flow. Just flow with the Spirit. God is calling you to new life. If you're here tonight and you're breathing, God says, I make all things new. New depths, new beginnings. Because if we think the same way, pray the same way, believe God to only work in a certain way, guess what? We'll be right. We may never experience change, the change that call inside of God. In imitation of Christ, we need to pray like Jesus. So we look at the scriptures, we need to go to a lonely place to pray, a deserted place to pray. If we're to be Christ-like, we should begin to pray the way Jesus prayed. And Jesus went to new places, lonely places, deserted places. Jesus prayed differently, and Jesus prayed more deeply. He went up the mountain, not to learn about God, not to study God. He went up the mountain to experience God like Moses. He wanted to know God. He wanted to commune with God, his Abba. I remember being in Europe, and there was a Jewish man in front of me holding his son's hand, and I saw him get separated in the crowd, and the little boy said, Abba, Abba. It was the first time I'd heard a Jewish child say the name Abba. It's Daddy, Daddy. So I have a hero, and I want to show a picture of him. Cool dude. He's got kind of a smirk on his face, like he knows something. I know you're going to put my picture on the wall in 50 years. The great spiritual writer, monk, mystic, imperfect Thomas Merton. And when I was 17, that same first year, I came across a book called he said in the book, no man is an island. No man or woman is an island. He said, a life not lived in the Spirit is illusory. When I read that, I went, oh my goodness, I can live this life, have all these experiences, make all these choices, and live in illusion and not even be in reality. It like struck me. Wake up, Tom. You can go 40 years and never really live. Thank you, Merton. That had to be the Spirit. Merton has this beautiful prayer. We're going to pray it together. What I want you to do, just so your body's kind of move, I'm going to have you stand. It's like that. You sit, you stand. You need a big money. You stand. Carl's going to play something beautiful. While we slowly say the famous prayer written by Thomas Merton. Do you have a, before we do the prayer, do you have, there's a little shack, a picture. Oh, I wanted to show you that. I want to say a bit more about Merton. So, after many years, and I'll be giving retreats on Merton at some point. But I got to go to the monastery and stay there. I got to go up to his cabin. But when I read about Merton, go ahead, that was beautiful, Carl. When I read about Merton is before he had a hermitage out in the woods, he discovered a tool shed in the late 40s, early 50s. And he asked his superior, may I have the tool shed to pray? What tool shed? The one out, it's a mile or so out there. He said, okay, I guess you could go out there once a day and meditate. That's it. I took that picture with my iPhone. That line that we just read, he wrote that line in that, right in there. My favorite book of his, New Seeds of Contemplation, he wrote in the tool shed. Merton gave his life away. Merton became a monk and he said, we're just too busy. We're like busybody monks. We're not praying and if we're not listening, we're just a plain church. And he wanted to go deeper. And he found this tool shed, and he would sit in it and be and listen and be still. And on the side over here, you can kind of see it on the side, he took something, he made a cross, and he called it St. Anne's. It's still there. See the cross? St. Anne's. St. Anne's. So we go back to that prayer. We pray. We ask Merton to pray with us tonight. My Lord God, I have no idea where I am going. I do not see the road ahead of me. I cannot know for certain. Thomas Merton is truly a great example of someone who went inside to discover God inside. Merton learned to breathe deeply and to inhale, to imitate the first and foremost Christian, Mary. Women, you're always really showing the way. Starting with Our Lady. Merton actually fell in love in the mid-60s. He fell in love with his nurse. Not something you're supposed to do when you're a monk. And he wasn't. But Merton was a human and was faithful to his vows, stayed in the monastery, lived out the rest of his life there, died, of course, in 1968. And he had friends like Dorothy Day and friends like Martin Luther King. You know, on April 4th, 1968, Dr. King was assassinated. And his calendar and Merton's calendar was, go meet Monk Merton at Gethsemane. He was needed in Memphis, but his schedule was to be with Thomas Merton that day. So we go back to heart. God alone is enough. All we need is a tool shed. A tool shed will do. Prayer as listening versus prayer as talking. And living a creative and artistic and holy life for God and others. And Dorothy Day, what an experience she was. So as you exhale, as we finish over the next half hour, about what does exhaling look like in your life? I don't know, but God knows you. And we're going to commission you tonight and re-encourage you to be versus always do. Mother Teresa might be a great example. She was just present and aware. That's how she saw that kid. That's how she saw that kid. No one else saw that kid. So your exhale might be music. You might be called to priesthood. You might be called to diaconate, to be a sister. It might be a school teacher, to be mom or dad or banker or tax accountant. It might mean baking chocolate chip cookies dipped in chocolate. Or knowing how to make a beautiful Italian meal for this tired guy that's been on the road for years and years and just feed him. It might mean helping two knucklehead musicians with CD sales. Or running that computer over there. Or driving to Boston. St. Paul says this, may the God of peace make you perfect in holiness. May he preserve you whole and entire. Read it with me. Spirit, soul, and body, irreproachable at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. So now, as we move out, spiritual choices become, what do we eat? So my wife and I are now plant-based eating. We're trying to eat differently. What we read becomes a spiritual choice. Exercise isn't just, I need to get stronger. It's taking care of brother or sister body. The importance of rest, the importance of a day off, the importance of learning how to pray. So, with this inner life, as we close this, I want to encourage you to spend time in silence, in meditation, in quiet breathing prayer. That's why it was so important. We did adoration, but you can't always come to adoration. You can sit at home and be. Don't just do something, sit there. You have the right to remain silent. That's how you were made. When we don't do that, if that's not a part of our life, there's something wrong. That's how we're designed. That's how Jesus prayed. How do we think we can do something different? And as we move past this, I want to suggest, if you want to write down some of this or we put it up at the end, read the Bible. Yes, read the Bible. That's enough. Make sure it's sitting around and handy. There's a great book, Prayer in the Cave of the Heart. Beautiful book about the interior of life. I love this book by Father James Martinus, a Jesuit. Becoming Who You Are. There's no excuse. It's only like 30 pages. Becoming Who You Are. You want to write that down? Write that down. And the books about Henry Nouwen, Mother Teresa, Thomas Merton, and Dorothy Day. John Michael Talbot, that book that I showed you last night, The World is My Cloister. My favorite book about the interior life, Arise My Love, by a brilliant Jesuit, William Johnston. Merton's books, New Seeds of Contemplation. Henry Nouwen's book, John of the Cross, Teresa of Avila, Hildegard of Bingen, Pierre de Desharnais, Father Richard Rohr, Thomas Keating, Charles de Foucault. We Catholics have a treasure trove. We're so rich, and yet we act so poor. So, when we move out of the cave of the heart, now we're going out. Contemplatives don't sit in a corner and wife. Your pretty lips all in a row. I love to touch the hem of your robe. You had no place to take them, so you did not take a wife. It's not. Oh, you did not take a wife.
Thank you.
The lesson, I guess, that we want to share is that Rich is so imperfect. Merton, so imperfect. Dorothy Day, we'll talk about her, so imperfect. We are so imperfect. And I was talking with Father Steve about this. He said, you know, sometimes we see our imperfections and we say, we just don't go out. We don't reach out because we think, who am I? I know me, right? We know ourselves, so we don't. But we are it. We are to be who we're called to be. Merton talked a lot about the false self, the ego self, and the true self. And I love that image of, he said we can actually, without conversion, without transformation, we perfect the false self to the point that we actually think that's who we are. We never really discover who we are. So, now, I think we have a picture of Dorothy Day. Here's our girl. Anybody familiar with Dorothy Day? Beautiful. Dorothy Day founded the Catholic Worker Movement, hospitality houses, fed the poor, her homes all across the country. Dorothy Day loved literature. She was a communist. She had an abortion. Dorothy Day was not perfect. Dorothy Day fell in love again, though she had really been treated poorly by the first dude. He said, if you have an abortion, I'll be here for you. So she had the abortion and she went back. There was only a note. She was afraid to love, but she eventually fell in love.
Church was, I think it was St. Patrick's, filled. He
said, the cardinal, who had always kind of had this relationship, said, I think we're burying a saint today. In her own life, she said, don't make me a saint too quickly. I don't want to be so easily dismissed. I would say, my friends, in this beautiful community, as we challenge ourselves to go out and to, we're never going to get our act together. We're always going to struggle because we're human. But to have the courage of her, the courage of Our Lady, the courage of Dorothy Day, the courage of Mother Teresa, the courage of John Paul, and to be the hands and feet of Jesus to those around us, to our sister, to our dad. Tonight, I want you to be thinking about something we're going to do tonight as we end. We're not ending just yet, but we have the baptismal font up here. I want you to begin to prepare yourself. You don't have to do this, but you're invited to. We're going to sing a song called You Welcome to Me. It's off the new album we keep talking about that we don't have yet, but we're kind of excited about it. I did talk to Father Steve. It comes out the first week of December. I'm either going to send him a box or put a thing in the bulletin. I want it to come out here. I want this to be the first church that has a CD. I promise you. I'm going to tell the record company, send them here to him. And then you figure it out. And if you want to get the discount I get, you guys keep the money. Seriously, do it. Take them all to dinner. Italian. Desperately looking for my pit, I promised to give it to Tommy. So if we could meditate on these words. I was asked to write this song just a couple of years ago with the Iraqi immigration crisis. A lot of the Catholic Christians in Iraq were being, a lot of those awful videos that we see, ISIS, those are Catholics. And this holy couple called me and said, we're having this thing and we want you to write a song and you would come sing it. And I said, that sounds wonderful, but I'm back east and I can't do it. And they said, okay. And then we hung up and then they called back. No, you're supposed to do it. And I go, they said, video. Write the song and we'll do a video and then you can sing it on the video. I said, okay. So we prayed on this. That's the title song of the new album. I pray it inspires us and you, Father, all of us together, to welcome the poor. Welcome those who maybe really turn us off. You know, Mother Teresa at the train station, and she used to go to teach before she was Mother Teresa of Calcutta. She was just a school teacher. She ignored the pleas of the train station. Help, help. She didn't want to look. And then she said, but one day that she looked down, and she didn't ignore, and she looked into the face of that beggar, and she literally saw Jesus' face. I was hungry, and you gave I was thinking. a stranger lacking hope. When were you naked, sick or in prison? And when did we not visit you?
Pacific Ocean at the bottom of a cliff with a monastery above.
Until the end of the age. invite you now, just in a spirit of reverence, to approach this baptismal font, symbolic of the baptismal font where we receive new life in Christ, and to use this as a time to renew our commitment to the Lord, to receive from Him that gift of life that we received on the day of our baptism, to receive that life, and as we approach that water, and perhaps put our hand and make the sign of the cross in your own way,
Beautiful painting of Our Lady of Guadalupe. And I was
I was sitting waiting for Mass to start. You ever had when your eyes are closed and somebody walks up to you and you know they're there, you feel it? So I open my eyes and this beautiful young lady, my age, beautiful. She said, "This is for you." And she put out her hand and there was a beautiful holy medal of Our Lady. And I was like, whoa. Kind of in my heart, I heard, "I accept." And then as soon as that occurred to me, then I was like, "Who is that girl?" I went to daily mass for 3 weeks after that. I never saw her again. Ever. And so I wrote this song for Mary, and we share it with you as we end the mission. I went to Medjugorje, Yugoslavia, and sang it to the visionaries there, and they brought us into the room during the apparition. And I was talking to one of the visionaries, and they were translating the song, and she said, this is someone who's like seeing Mary every week or something. She said, "It is not my lady, it is our lady." And I said, leave it to me to go to Yugoslavia. But the next month I was in Mexico, I was at the Basilica of Our Lady of Guadalupe, and they were telling us about the apparitions. And I'd written this song, right? And they said to me, you come in, past this gate, past this gate, past this gate, sit on the spot where Juan Diego saw Mary, and sing your song in Spanish. And I translated it, so I did. Here's what's so cool. The woman who runs all the tours, she said, "Do you know what Juan Diego, how he addressed Our Lady, the Virgin?" I said, "No, my lady." Oh.